I wasn't the typical drug addict that sort of grew up in a broken home. You would normally think that, you know, they come from the wrong side of the track, grew up in some kind of broken home. You know, my parents were married for 42 years, and my dad was a firefighter. Mum worked in an auto auctions, and they were very good to me. And but, you know, from an early age, I felt like there was something missing. As I went through sort of school, went through high school, I was bullied in high school, and I was like a little fat kid that used to get bullied quite a bit. And came home one day, and Mum thought, you know, the answer to that was to put me in karate lessons. So there I was, starting karate, and you know, I'd be up the back of the class, and I'd have my white gi on, my white belt, and they couldn't contain my stomach would fall out through my gi, and I really wasn't that good at it. But you know, my sensei took a liking to me, and I think it was like his pet project, and from that attention, from that encouragement, I began to flourish in that environment of encouragement. You know, one of the things about that I've learnt over time is that we face so much criticism in life that just a couple of words of encouragement can bring you back into that place of being motivated again. And so that was me. I was motivated in karate, and I did quite well at it. You know, as I was growing up too, my sister went on a different path. My sister became a supermodel. In fact, she was, at the age of 15, she did the original Decore ad. Some of you might remember it, that Decore ad. She was the blonde girl that swooshed her hair at the end, and she started to get famous quite early in life. And, you know, the shampoo company would send us these lifestyle posters of my sister, and there'd be little posted size picture of me on the mantelpiece there. But, you know, I guess, you know, I always sort of struggled with that identity factor in life, of who I was. And I guess in the shadow of my sister being quite successful, I didn't resent her for having that success. I thought, great, but where do I fit in the mix? And so I guess for me, I started to seek bad attention, or negative attention rather than positive attention. And I still was quite responsible as I grew up. You know, I got quite good at karate. I was a tradesman chef at the time, and was paying off my own house. And by the age of 22, from the outside, I would look quite successful. You know, having a mortgage on my house at 22, having this girlfriend I'd gone out with for a long time, would probably got married, and a karate school, and working at the Brisbane casino as a chef. And but you know what? I was still missing that thing. And one day a karate sensei came around with two needles full of amphetamines. Well, you know, drugs were never my thing, really. You know, I'd go out drinking with the boys, and we'd get in a few fights and stuff. But I tried marijuana. I actually was quite paranoid on marijuana. I'd just have a little demon speak in my ears. Oh, they're going to go get you. They're going to get you. You know, I'd be crawling out the bathroom window trying to get away from them. And then I'd be driving up the highway, doing 20 k's in my car, and feel like my car was this big and the highway was this big, and it was not the ideal feeling for me. But when I tried this speed, this amphetamines, and I mainlined it for the very first time, because I this guy had influence over me. I looked up to him. He was able to influence me to take that first needle in my arm, and I've got to tell you, from that moment, I felt like this is what I've been looking for all my life. I felt this rush through my veins that gave me confidence, made me feel like I was Superman, I could do anything. And it felt like it was just that missing thing. And so, you know, I remember actually thinking after that first hit that, gee, I better be careful because I could get addicted to this. Well, you know, as time went on, you know, well, I would catch up with my mate, and, you know, we'd use the drugs again, and we'd go out, and you know, it was like, you know, once every month and a half or something. And then it became once every month, and then once every 2 weeks, and then once every week. And in a matter of about 6 years, I was using it every day. Got to the point where I was using it every day, and I had a $500 a day habit. I couldn't sustain that with any kind of job. I thought, I'd seen a couple of my mates doing drug dealing. I thought, oh, that's what I'll do. I'll be a drug dealer. I'll be good at that. But of course, I was terrible at it because I was sharing all the drugs with all my mates and I was using too much of my own product. And ended up owing my drug dealer $10,000. Well, you know, I was on the run from him for a little while, just ducking and weaving, and then, but one day he caught up with me, and he came around to my house, and he said, you need to pay up. And, you know, a couple of things had happened during that time, as I was going around the valley in Brisbane, and I was selling drugs and everything, and I'd had a couple of impressive street fights, and the reputation had gone around, and by the time it had got back to my deal, it was like a Jackie Chan movie. Because Chinese whispers and, you know, it just got better and better every time it got told. And so my reputation just preceded me, and it really wasn't, half it wasn't true. You know, like, you know, he beat up these 15 guys and whatever, you know, it wasn't really true. But I didn't correct him. In fact, he offered me a job at that point. He said, listen, you can pay off your debt. I need someone to watch my back in the clubs and I need someone to do some collections for me. Well, I didn't mind the whole watching his back in the club because, you know, I felt like a bit of a superstar. I'd walk in and the DJ would sort of stop all the music, and this guy's nickname was the doctor because he was the drug dealer, come in and just fix everyone up, and then they'd play this song, and watch out for the hitman, and I'd walk in thinking, you know, yeah, I'm the man, and all just in that fake world. But then the collections came, and what they were was home invasions on drug dealers and addicts, and it was just a horrible, horrible world. I had to take copious amounts of drugs to actually even do the evil things that I did and terrorise these people who I didn't even know. And it just, my conscience began to get seared. And I began to just, you know, I guess get off on the adrenaline of it all. And I was, my dealer was giving me drugs and money and girls, and the power of it all ended up just being intoxicating. And, you know, I did that for a while and got around and you know, and people were after me and I was after people. And, you know, I worked for some pretty heavy people, which I'm not going to talk about on this podcast, but some of those people, you know, would kill you in a heartbeat. And I remember getting to a point in my life where it was after one day, I'd been up for about 3 or 4 nights. And I was just psychotic, and I was walking up Chinatown Mall. I'm walking up like this, like, and just looking psychotic, and everyone's peeling left and right. And then I remember just sitting down and thinking, how did my life become this? You know, there's a story in the Bible called the Prodigal Son, and it's about two sons, had a father and who was quite wealthy, and one of the sons came and got his inheritance early and ran off and squandered it with prodigal living. And he ended up just losing everything and ended up in a pig pen eating the actual pig food. And the Bible actually says that in that moment he came to himself and realized that it wasn't so bad in his father's house. Even being a servant in his father's house was better than the life he was living now. Well, that kind of happened to me. I had this moment of coming to myself. I'm like, how did my life become this? You know, when I was growing up in school, you know, and like the teacher says, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, I didn't put up my hand and say, oh, I want to be this horrible standover, violent guy or drug dealer or, you know, it wasn't that, you know, but that's what my life had become through this setup, through this maze of, and where the drugs had taken me. I lived to use and I used to live. And it got to that point where I just went, nah, I need to stop this. So anyway, I rang up my sister in America, said, look, you know, I haven't been honest with you. I've been dealing drugs and I've been taking heaps of drugs. I'm hopelessly addicted to these drugs. And you know, she said, well, we need to get you some help. I said, no, I can do it. I'll just ring up mum and dad and I'll go home for a while and I'll dry out and everything will be all right. Anyway, I went into hiding at my mum and dad's place, just sort of, you know, just no phones, no nothing. But it wasn't too long before that drive, that compulsion on the inside of me. Now, someone said to me that when you put a needle in your arm, you invite an evil spirit to come and live on the inside of you. Well, I had personally experienced that, where the drive for the addiction, the drive for the drugs, took over every rationale in my life. And, well, I just started bringing all that heat into my parents' house, and it just ended up all coming there. And I, that was really another rock bottom for me. So, and my friend got locked up for 6 years for doing home invasions, and I dodged the bullet. And so it was a terrible situation. And I remember my mum, you know, such a sweet, sweet lady. But she's a little bit gullible, and, you know, addicts are very good manipulators. You know, she found some needles in my bag, and she said, "What's this, son? What are you using again?" And I said, "No, mum, I'm doing a community service. I'm there's all of my mates out there using drugs, and I want to make sure that they have clean needles." And of course, mum wanted to believe me. She bought that hook, line, and sinker. And she told my sister in America, and my sister said, "Oh, mum, he's using." And so, you know, she'd learned about this intervention program, addict intervention program. And for those that don't know what that is, that's basically a surprise party for the addict. An addict doesn't know anything about it, and he turns up, and all the family and friends are there to confront the addict on their addiction. Well, they pulled this thing on me, and I turned up, and I was filthy. I was like, "Who the hell are you? What are you doing?" I think I walked out about two or three times, but you know, the love of my family just really, even through all my hardness and anger and how I changed in my personality, just the love slipped under the guard and went into my heart. It's this perfect love that just cast out the fear at that time. And they said, "Look, we want you going to detox tonight. We've got the car filled up with fuel." And I'm thinking, "Oh, that's a bit presumptuous, you know, like you're ready to take me now." And I tried to talk, weasel my way out of it, but they were having no bar of it. And anyway, I went into detox that night, and I was so sick. At that point, I was really sick. My inside of my throat had blisters on it from shooting up pure meth, and my mouth was like I've been chewing on barbed wire, just full of ulcers from the coke. And I was probably, I think I was about 75 kilos or something, you know. Today I'm 115, and you know, I was a sick boy, and they took me into detox. It was a private hospital, and I spent 10 days in there, and they used to call me Mad Mick in that place. And then I went on to do a long-term rehab program down the Gold Coast, and I did 9 months in that rehab. And I was the poster boy for anger in that place, and I got so many disciplinary things, but I finally I graduated that program. Now, after 9 months in that program, like, I'd had all the psychotherapy, like, I knew what was, you know, why I'd used the emotional perplexities, and I went back to doing cooking, and there was something missing, you know. First of all, that I was missing a real connection, a real inside. I felt like there was something missing, but I also was missing purpose. See, I felt like I had a purpose in that world. It was an extreme lifestyle, up and down. And to have this boring, mundane, normal life was just inconceivable to me. I didn't know how I was going to live like that. In fact, inside, I always felt like I was born for purpose, but I obviously went down the wrong path for purpose. So anyway, I started drinking in the halfway house there. I got chucked out, and while I was drinking alcohol, it was a bit of a gateway for me, and I was holding on by my fingertips not to use my drug of choice again. And it was a battle. I didn't want to lose that clean time. So I started to go to 12-step meetings, Narcotics Anonymous, Alcoholics Anonymous. And I saw the 12 steps as a pathway to God. I saw that and I went, right, that looks like a pathway to God to me. And so I started looking for God myself. I went to the Hare Krishnas, had a little boogie and a free veggie meal with them. And I went there for a couple of months, but I just felt like it just wasn't really what I was looking for. It didn't click into place for me, and I tried to meditate, but I've got way too much ADD to meditate. I'd sit there and it would cause me more anxiety to meditate, because my brain would be going off, and so that didn't work for me. Next thing I'd I'd hooked up with this girl at one of the meetings, and she was into crystals, and she said, look, here, have this pink crystal and it'll help you when you have anxiety. And so, you know, one day I was feeling a little bit anxious and a bit sort of, you know, out of sorts, didn't have peace, and I reached in the pocket and I felt this crystal. I thought, oh, that's right, the crystal. And I started rubbing it, thinking, this is going to get rid of me, this is going to make me feel peace, it's going to really... After a while, I nearly rubbed my fingerprint off. I was, it didn't work. It was causing me more anxiety again. I just threw that away. I thought, that's just a rock. That's not going to help me. Anyway, I was looking for a real God. You know, I was, where am I going to find a real God? And I'd almost given up when my mate said to me, he said, why don't you come to church? I said, what for? And he goes, well, you're looking for God, aren't you? I said, God's not in church, mate. I've been Catholic church. Stand up, sit down, stand up, sit down. Look at the stained glass windows. God's not in church, mate. He goes, no, this church is different. Well, he wasn't wrong. He dragged me along to church that Sunday, and it was a Pentecostal church. Everyone's clapping. And it wasn't just a Pentecostal church. It was a church in the midst of what they call a revival. And it was like, it was literally the equivalent. What I would say is, like, I used to go to these raves where everybody get off their face on drugs. This was like the Christian version of it. And I'm looking around, I'm thinking, how can all these people be so happy and not be on something? They must be releasing something through the air conditioners or something like that. You know, I thought, this is crazy. And I was a bit freaked out by it too. And I'd stand up the back like this, and I with this look on my face. And I remember Larry, the overzealous greeter guy, come up with his big painted on smile. He goes, hi, welcome to such and such church. And I said, listen, Larry, I know you're just doing your job, but if you ever approach me again, I'm just going to punch you right in the face. He goes, oh, okay then. Anyway, Larry didn't come near me again. And I want to make sure. I didn't want to know anybody. Certainly didn't want to join the club. I was just there to find out if God was real. Well, anyway, after the first time I'd been to that church, I was always assessing my level of peace. I was always assessing my anxiety levels and my level of blessing in the week, how my week was going. After I'd been to church, my week was better. And that's the only thing I'd done differently that week. So I went back to church just purely as a good luck charm. And I kept going back week after week. But I would make sure I was out of there before anyone could try and rope me in or talk to me. I didn't want to talk to anyone. And I guess I was going for about 2 months, and I was standing up the back. And this is what absolutely changed me. It was this moment, a defining moment where God reached out from heaven and showed me that he was real. And I was standing in the service like this, in my usual position. And all of a sudden, I felt this energy come over me, this warmth and goosebumps were going in it. And just this incredible warmth and energy that went all the way down, swirled around me, down to the soles of my feet. And I went, whoa, what was that? Best way I could describe it was like liquid love hit me from the top of my head down the soles of my feet. And it was the maddest rush I'd ever felt. You talk about, like, this is what I've been looking for all my life. This was the real deal. And I thought, I've never had a rush like that. No needle on my arm, no drug I've ever taken has made me feel like that. And it was clean, it was pure, and it was like, but it was real. And I looked around, I thought someone had touched me. I didn't know where it was coming from. I nudged the guy beside me. I said, did you feel that? And he goes, feel what? And I described the feeling to him, the goosebumps, the warmth. And he goes, oh, that's the Holy Spirit. He said it like a matter-of-fact thing, like as if everybody should know what that is. I'm like, well, what Holy Spirit, what is it? How do I get more of that stuff? And the guy goes, oh, I don't know, mate. I don't know. And I'm thinking, why can't you tell me? You know, I knew how to get the drugs, ring up the dealer, pay the dealer, get the drugs. But I didn't know how to get all this new stuff, you know. So I just started asking everyone, hey, how'd you get that stuff? How'd you get this stuff? Anyway, by the end of the service that day, there was a preacher up the front. I just sort of used to switch off with the preaching. But this day, some of the words got in, and this guy's going, you know, if you'd like to receive Jesus in your heart today and have all your sins washed away. No need to tell me I was a sinner. I knew I was a good sinner. Anyway, I remember my head going, no, don't do it. You'll be an idiot. And then my heart, I felt like this voice saying, this is what we've been looking for all our life. This is home. This is it. This is the time. This is, And my head's going, no, don't do it. Just take a look at them. You'll become like them. And I look at them and go, no, you're right. And then my heart would go, no. Anyway, there's this like argument going on. I felt like a schizophrenic, back and forth between my head and my heart. And before I could, my head could talk me out of it, my heart dragged me up to that altar that day, and I fell on my knees. And all this funny stuff was coming out of my eyes that hadn't been there for a while. And I started crying like a baby. And the guy hadn't even finished his spiel yet. He come up and he goes, mate, are you all right? And I said, oh, he's on the back and I'm just stopping it. Here I am. And he's like, oh, mate, just stay there. We'll sort you out. Anyway, they led me off with these other people and off to some side room. And there's this young little nerdy Flanders looking guy, little nerdy guy, Christian guy. And he's got this little clipboard and he's going, well, now that you've become a Christian, and I said, hang on, hey, whoa. I haven't signed up to your club. I haven't become a Christian. Listen, I just want to know how you get some more of that stuff. He goes, what stuff? I said, God called it the Holy Spirit. I want, how do I get more of that stuff? And he goes, oh, I don't know, mate. I'm just trying to do the job. Can you just fill out the form? I'm like, nah, I'm out of here. Anyway, next week I'm thinking, oh, maybe if you clap, you get it. You know, because I thought, saw everyone clapping it. Maybe if you put your hands up, you get it. And none of it worked for me. And I'd just go back to my normal posture. And then I'd get hit with another wave. And I think, oh, how do you get it? I even did my own research. I started kicking people up the front when they'd fall over. And I'd say, hey, what are you feeling? And how did you get it? And no one could tell me. But I after a while, I put two and two together. And I worked out, when you play the church music, the stuff comes. So I thought, I'm onto this. No one can tell me. They're keeping this from me, holding out on me, but I'm just going to buy one of them little CDs with the church music on it, and I'll take it home and put it in my little CD player. So I did that. And I pushed play, and I lay back in the lounge room. And to my surprise, I'm getting hit with wave after wave of this beautiful liquid love hit me. And I had this thought. I thought, every drug dealer, every drug addict, every gangster, everyone needs to feel this stuff, because this is the essence of what we've been looking for, and we've been feeling it in our veins and up our nose, but this was the real deal. And I thought, man, now I've got it on tap and it's free. And so I went back to the rehab where I used to volunteer. I said, hey guys, come along to my house on Monday night, and you know, I've got stuff there that doesn't come up on the drug test, mate. Come along. And I'll go out the street and I'd say, hey, you don't want any of that stuff. We've got better stuff at my place. And this Christian had moved into my house, and he was from the church. And he said, he put up some little cards and said, we have stuff you know not of. And we started handing them out, and we had little, you know, the time and the address. And anyway, I had 15 people turn up to my house that night. I thought, oh, what the heck? What am I doing now? And anyway, this one bloke comes in. He goes, where's the stuff, man? I said, look, you know, just hold on, you know, we'll be here soon. You know, I knew addicts are used to waiting anyway. So, and I just had everyone in, shut the door, dim the lights and push play and hope for the best. Well, I've got to tell you, to my amazement, I just shut my eyes. And I was feeling these mad rushes over me. I thought, everyone else must feel the same thing. And everything was quiet. And I just opened one eye at one point, just had a look around. I saw these hardened guys. Tears running down their face. I saw people shaking and just people falling down and to their knees and praying to God, but probably never prayed to God before. And after that night, everyone's like, man, well, this is mad. What is it? I said, I don't know, man. I just push play. There's more stuff at the church. anyway, and then they'd come on Sunday and they'd give their lives to the Lord. And then. It became a phenomenon. We're there till their friends, and they tell their friends. One time, I had 30 people in my lounge room, woke up and my stereo equipment was gone. A few other things were gone, but it was the most amazing time. And I remember thinking too, that because they were going back to their drug dens, one guy even paid for a prostitute, paid for a hooker for an hour, brought her along to the meeting, and she got touched by the power of God. And she said, I don't want to do this anymore. And I had 30 people. What am I going to do with these people? And I knew enough about starting a little program that I decided I was just going to start a program. I went to the pastor, asked if I could rent a little house next door to the church, and all of a sudden that was full, you know, filled up, little program, and very basic in those days. I think I only had about 10 rules, And then start another one. Before I knew it, I had 5 houses on the Gold Coast. And I was still working a full-time job. And all these people were coming through, and they were really finding their identity and purpose and everything, and going on to live great lives. It evolved over 10 years and became a Queensland Health accredited drug and alcohol rehabilitation program. I left my job, I educated myself, got another 3 diplomas in, I did Bible college, then I got another 3 diplomas in mental health, in addictions, in community welfare and counselling. And the program evolved over that time to become an incredible program. And I remember thinking one day, I just sat down and I thought, God, it's amazing what you've done. It's amazing what has happened, and the people, the pure gold that's come out of that program, the diamonds that have come out. And I said to God, because I like talking to God and he talks to me, it's pretty cool. When you got this relationship, I actually hear him. And you'll find out in a minute, because like this, I couldn't have made this up, right? I said, God, why do you like using drug addicts and alcoholics so much? And I'll never forget it. He said, son, they're the only people that I can find that know what it's like to live for just one thing. Single-minded, know what it's like to live for just one thing. Well, I knew what that was like, to be completely obsessed and sold out for drugs. And I've seen that happen over and over again. There's another story in the Bible about a sinful woman, an adulteress, and she was at these tax collectors' house, and these people of high stature. And she sat down at Jesus' feet and worshipped him, and with her tears just pouring down on his feet, and she dried his feet with her hair, and she broke this perfume, this precious perfume, in an alabaster box all over his feet. And the well-to-do people said, oh, if he only knew what a sinner she was. And Jesus turned around and said, because she's been forgiven much, she loves much. And I've seen that happen time and time again with addicts and people who've hit a rock bottom, and they've literally only got a little bit of air in their lungs. And God doesn't give up on them. A bruised reed he won't break, a smoldering flax he won't put out. So long as someone has air in their lungs, we might give up on them, but God never does. And I guess I've been a recycler of human beings with God's help for the last 22 years. And you might be listening to this today, and you're getting touched. You can feel that stuff I was talking about. You can feel it starting to come upon you. And God's in your lounge room or wherever you are right now. He's there with you. Because I know that I know that I know that he leaves 99 righteous people to go after one that's out there that doesn't know him. And he's reaching out to you today, friend. While you listen to my voice, I want you to consider. I want you to consider letting him take over your life. You know, I controlled everything in my life. I was very angry, but I became completely powerless. Maybe you're feeling that powerlessness today, feeling a struggle in your life, and you've come to that point where you know something needs to change. Well, I want to tell you, there's a scripture in the Bible that says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone would open up to me, I will come in. And right now, as you're sitting there, I want to pray a prayer with you. And I can feel God's heart for you listening right now. Why don't you just, you know, if you mean business with God, God means business with you. With all your heart, just repeat this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for dying upon that cross for me. It was my sin that put you there, but I thank you that you took my place on that cross. I believe that you're the Savior of the world and you're the Son of God, and that you were raised on the third day back to life and now sit in heaven with the Father. I want to take that invitation, Jesus, and I want to invite you to come into my heart. Cleanse me, wash me of all my sin, make me brand new. Jesus, today, I give my life to you, now and forevermore, Amen. Well, friend, if you prayed that prayer, you're on the best journey of your life, and you've just started the first day of the rest of your life with a companion that sticks closer than a brother. God bless you. Thanks for listening.